Hello, greetings. This is Gilles Mancillon. I am guided to come to you to offer guidance and practical advice. For I know those everything that comes out of those oracle cards from the archangels are quite wise, and so there is applicable wisdom in those messages. The highest wisdom for us today is the Nine of Ariel, for it is the dream that are becoming reality. We have nothing without nothing. Loving the beautiful things that life offers. So she's riding a unicorn, and there is the rainbow of possibilities that she's riding, and so all things are becoming possible, and the dreams are becoming manifest. What we need to understand is the four of Ariel. Giving is also receiving, resisting change. Know how to spend or save your money. So it is very much a card that usually is symbolistic of discipline, of being organized, being wise. But there is a certain rigidity to it. So we do not want to be too rigid. We want to understand life is a flow that we give and receive, and it is it's a balance of energy. We have more of Ariel cards. So the third three of Ariels, the beautiful box here, says do what you love, professional or artistic evolution. Working in team or cooperating. So it is very, it's like the discovery of this treasure. So it is, and working with those magnificent energy and working together to make things for when we unite, we become one, we cooperate, we achieve far more than what we can do alone. Yet there is the power, and we are not limited as individual either. We have our own plans. And so the general message for us today is the King of Michael has principles, rational, ambitious, respected. Come into wisdom and objectivity. Be honest. The situation must be handled with honesty and necessitate good communication. So in essence, it is a business card. It is the card where you assume the responsibility with fairness that you have, and then there is more to come. I'm going to pull out four cards from the Akash, see if what we can gain as information from the Akash. The past life Akash are basically triggers that allow us to reintegrate for the most important thing we need to do in a life. Life has a personal meaning for each and every one of us, but reintegration of memory, who we were, who we are, who we will be, is very important for we have, in the Akash, there is past, present, and future memories that can unfold into our mind, and we have to integrate that. The highest wisdom for us today is finance, is the administration of finance and the moving into a higher flow where we feel we no longer have to worry about money, but it becomes a flow, permanent flow. What we need to understand is persecution and inquisition for this money has been hijacked, and so we have to liberate the flows of abundance for a long time. There were anything that the system of control over the collective evolution of human beings was really narrow. Now it is the time of awakening, and so we are being let us see what we'll need to understand. Then the next step, what we'll need to understand, is the balancing out of the idea of relationship, for we are we are moving into Leo, and so happy birthday to all the Leos. Leo is the self. We move from the moon in Cancer. The sun moved into the fulfillment of the heart of the sun. So it is a time that is always very passionate, but in many sense soon Venus will move from Virgo into balance and into Libra, and it will illuminate all of the social possibility for romance and all those things. For that is a very personal. What we need to do is the mother. So whatever that means for you, for it is about the idea of nurturing, to nurture whatever we need to nurture. And the general message for us today is wisdom. So it is about understanding what to do. The wisdom is essentially the means. Love is the knowledge of things, but wisdom is the means by which to achieve. And so this is given, and so we shall be grateful in receiving it whenever we receive that. The painting behind me is a small painting, and it's an interior from 2005. there is this door here on the side, and then on an easel there is an unfinished canvas, and there is three paintings on the wall. One is a Mondrian, the other one is like a personal little, well, symbolistic of a Mondrian, of course, and this one is symbolistic of a Magritte. It is a pipe, and Magritte made those famous paintings, "This is not a pipe," and so I made this one, "This is not a Magritte." And then there is this kind of alien cone head kind of like figure here, and I was thinking, although it's very delicate to touch old paintings, to put a little ball hat, because it would reinforce the Magritte feeling, and it would really set the stage. So but it's delicate, it's been 13 years, so I'm something that may be coming, an evolution to that painting. It will may become like the little ball hat, may just complete the painting in a way I could not suspect, maybe. For I wanted to speak very briefly of course, if you have any comment or any anything, I always appreciate comments, and thank you for liking, sharing, and subscribing if you like those videos. There is this solar eclipse that we just this solar eclipse and new moons that was very powerful to help us, to assist, to change our habits, and whatever that is, to what we can do is maybe to change small habits before we can change big ones, but to understand that all the habits we have, if we can try different, we'll become more conscious rather than working through this unconscious automatic pilot kind of thing. So it is good to become more aware. I wanted to speak a bit about literature. I was studying Herodotus. Herodotus is the from Cicero, is the father of history. Why? Because it's 5th century philosopher that is the first one that did not get inspired by the muse. He was inspired by his reasoning. But that brought me back to return to Homer. Homer, the Odyssey of Homer, Odysseus, is really a wonderful book. I really, really recommend. It's been the book that has mystified the mind of all philosophers. Some of them did, but it's very, very powerful. I also was happy to go back into Aristotle because it helps me understand Dante, which is a very, very powerful poet for me. I also wanted to say I questioned the idea that Aristotle was mentioning India, how the Indian live, and so I talked to a friend of mine who's made a thesis in about Plato in Greek, and he read all those, and so he told me that even in Plato they could see the influence of the Buddhist missionaries that already came to Greece at this time, and we can see in Plato some influence from the Buddha, but in Aristotle we don't really see that. It's more, but it's far more aligned with Confucius, the middle way. Although I don't believe the Chinese came all the way down there at that time, I wanted to speak briefly about Stoicism. Stoicism is always to expect the best, but if the worst comes in, to deal with it with grace and ease. So you move into a state of total surrender. I wanted to address also two little movies that address philosophical ideas. The first one is in Matrix. There is this confrontation of position between Neo and this group who said that everything is about choice, and then there is the Merovingian that says no, everything is about cause and effect. Why? And in many sense, everything is about choice, what we choose to believe. But the cause and effect, it is not escapable. We cannot escape cause and effect. We can reunite cause and effect, and it's from there we gain the power when we understand the why. Why do we dance? Why do we sing? Why do we paint? Why do we do all the things we do? Why do we get up in the morning? We know we're going to have to go back to sleep. Why were we born? We know we're going to die. So why? Why do the flower bloom? Everything is to experience life, to celebrate life. It's my idea. You know? And so in many ways, but those things are not like their personal ideas, but everybody's got to define a sense of why those things. It is an important aspect, the causality aspect, and so that we become creator of our life. We do not do things unconsciously. Another movie that was also brought these philosophical ideas was in The Lord of the Ring. There is Gandalf, character named Gandalf that speaks to the character named Frodo, who's like, he says that it is not for you to decide the birth and death of any beings, because it's already been decided. The only thing you have to do is what you do with your time between your death and between your birth and your death. So to do what we do with our time during that. So we hopefully we want to make our life the most pleasant as possible. We want to step into our creator's shoes and move into joy. So I hope you avail yourself to not let yourself be dragged into anything, because the eclipse has really removed most of those old energies. So it is very much a time for joy and celebration, and soon there will be a great deal of romantic potential for those who are interested. Personally, I used to be in a lot of relationship when I was young. I almost got married 3 times, which I'm happy I didn't, because it would have not lasted. But when you move into spirituality, you realize most relationship you don't really need it, you know. It's like, because there is a sexual passion that you can fulfill without having a deep relationship, but when it comes to relationship, it is about being able to live together in peace and harmony, because when you live with someone, you have to take all their energy, the ups and downs, and all so it is. But then eventually when there is a real relationship, it becomes an absolute evidence. When it becomes an absolute evidence that two people are made to be together, they stay together. It is something we have to trust, that the universe will provide whatever we need when we need it in terms of relationships. I'm going to finish with a song. I'm sorry, I messed up a little bit the song yesterday. I was a little bit too ambitious with this song, singing this song, but I thank you. A lot of people liked it anyway, but I'm going to do this one. It's a song that talks about the coming age of light and allowing the sun, the inner sun in, and letting the sun shine. It goes like this. When the moon is in the seventh house and Jupiter aligns with Mars, then peace will guide the planets and love will steer the stars. This is the dawning of the age of Aquarius. Age of Aquarius, Aquarius, Aquarius. Harmony and understanding, sympathy and trust abounding, no more falsehoods or derisions, golden living dreams of visions, mystic crystal revelation, and the mind's true liberation. Aquarius, Aquarius. When the moon is in the seventh house and Jupiter aligns with Mars, then peace will guide the planets and love will steer the stars. This is the dawning of the age of Aquarius. Age of Aquarius, Aquarius, Aquarius. Let the sun shine. Let the sun shine in, the sun shine in. Let the sun shine. Let the sun shine in, the sun shine in. Let the sun shine. Let the sun shine in, the sun shine in. Well, I wish you a wonderful day. Please let your sun shine in, and I'll talk to you later. Namaste.